realizing that the children are now exposed to this kind of contents from either sides.
Mm, mm.
But before we get to that, I want you to first exhaust this issue of age. When should children, when can children actually be left with gadgets? But also, when are children supposed to be starting school? We've had that also conversation about age of children and what the children should be going through at particular ages.
Mm.
You can actually have some insights on that.
Okay, so going back to the issue of the gadgets, and actually you talked about the age.
Should you first actually expose the gadgets to children before they go to school or after they have gone to school?
These gadgets also I keep emphasizing the issue of the purpose. Why are you providing, like, for example, an iPad to a 3-year child? Or if you attempted to give that child that gadget, for how long should that child use it? Because for me, I still think that we should not be giving our children these gadgets as long as they're still very young. If there is no serious need for them. But if it's for like academic purposes, where they have to be like
academic purposes for a 3-year old?
Not 3-year old child. So that child could be like games. Just do the, even like I'm not even your children when you reach at home.
Yeah.
So that is just and they have their games on
yes.
our phones on
your and they know how to, yes, to access
them.
Yes.
To access them.
Mm.
And if you just see the apps on your phone, and then you only want to watch when they are playing and know what kind of game is this.
Mm.
So there, as you somehow don't want to let them be out of not because there's peer pressure, they're also like trying to compete with their colleagues.
Mm.
So somehow you can just okay, they just give you and you do what you want, like that game.
Mm.
So the content matters. The what the child is also using the phone for at that particular moment and for how long also matters.
Mm.
So the age group varies from the need.
But I said there should be like a minimum age.
The minimum age should be
First of all, for tech, but also for school.
Okay, well, no, we're still on tech. We're coming with school. So for me, on technology, my concern is about the need for
the purpose.
Moment, the purpose.
But once you clearly identify the purpose,
the
age may not matter.
The age may not matter. Because where we are now, that's the thing. It's like when like we're growing up, we don't know that having a phone was not necessary.
Mm.
No, when we were at campus, because I'm sure that we are age mates.
Mm.
It was not necessary. But now, a phone has become part of us.
Yes.
For different reasons. So even our children, the purpose matters.
Mm.
Then the age group can come in. And then also the content.
Mm.
The age appropriate content can come in. Now, when we come to the issue of when should the child start schooling, again, it comes back to our education system in Uganda. You know, the foremost education system is 7-4-2. 7 for primary school, from P1 to P7, then 4 for secondary, which we know as ordinary level, O level, then 2 years for advanced level, or upper secondary, which we all call A level. But then, now this is what is so common in private schools and government schools, is now that there's kindergarten or nursery, the preschool. Which is 3 years.
Mm.
Yes. Which is 3 years. According to the Minister of Education, the child should begin P1 when he's 6 years old.
Yes.
And that goes up to 12 years old. Because he spent 7 years,
so
that comes almost to 13 years.
Mm.
Then from there, you do the 4 years. So but this by 18, 19, you should be finishing senior six.
Mm.
But now, because we have nursery, and where now it has become a trend that your child must go through nursery, everywhere. From where I started from, there was no nursery. I started from P1C.
Yeah.
That was maybe like my baby class. Then I had P1B, P1A. But now, it's now P1, then the other categorizations are nursery. Baby class, you know, and even some come before baby class. So,
yes.
For me, I would say that at least at 4 years, that would be a good time for a child to begin nursery. But because of the pressures also somehow.
The children go early.
Go early.
Mm.
So even at 3 years, a child can go. But depending, 3 years, a child can start. But if you see that a child at 3 years is not able to do anything at school, and even you're just wasting your money, then why should you take that child at that age?
Yeah.
So depending on your cognitive ability, the cognitive ability of your child, which your parent can be assessing. You can say maybe at 3 years the child, because for us our children, we took them when they were 3 and a half. Almost all of them 3 and a half. Because all of them were able. Would see, would even do some practicals at home. You're doing something and say, read for me this, you give them some exercise. Then you would see that this child can do it. But now it is a change where most parents, because of especially the working class, they have no maid, they have nowhere to leave their children, and then they leave their children, they take their children to kindergarten.
You may, for example, control your children from these gadgets, but most of the schools now actually allow gadgets. And you know most of our children are in boarding schools.
In boarding schools.
How do you deal with that as a parent?
Now, then that goes back, first of all, that goes back to the schools. At what age should you give, and which class should you give a child a gadget? And what are they going to use it for?
Yes.
And then that should determine when you need to give this child that gadget.
Uh-huh.
And then for you as a parent, how do you monitor? Go for visits. Visit your child. Especially some schools have scheduled visiting days. Others can allow you at any time. Though identify those parents who visit their children now and then, so don't overdo it.
Because the more
you overdo it, you obstruct them. So it shouldn't be so frequent. But at least always have visits. In a period where maybe the school...
Impromptu visits.
Yes, impromptu visits.
Yes, when, yeah, check and see, yeah, check what and is see. Going on.
Yeah. Actually, you also go and attend classes.
Is that allowed?
Like for me, every time I go to school, I sometimes want to monitor and see what is being done. School, but you know, this day schools are understanding. These things of...
You're allowed to go inside and sit in class.
Yeah, you can see, I want to see how my child is doing. I want to just be there and see what is happening, what is teaching. Because if a child
peeping
is
inside, you know, from maybe...
If
you're
sitting in
from
class, if a teacher is confident of what he's teaching, why is he concerned that you're going to sit there? Are you going to stop him from... You're not supervising him.
I have not seen that before.
Me, I've had people, like, for example, you know Dr. Senyon.
From UCU.
Now he's a former VC, he's retired from UCU. But he says that for him, he used to do it with his children. For me, I have noted, I want to start doing it, I've not yet done it. But at least every time I take my children, I'm so much interested.
In knowing how they are taught you know, they are connected.
I greet the head teacher, I greet their teachers. I just don't drop and run away.
Yeah.
I just drop them and first see what is happening. They have entered. I see the teacher. I just, you know. But at the beginning of the term, when they are reporting, I make sure that I enter in their classes and greet these children. So they know me as the parent of my children. Greet them. What does it cost me? I know that my children's teachers, I have their contact.
But Dixon, where do you get all this time? We are working parents.
But you know, that's what I was going to say. You're working, we are investing for our children. Actually, we don't even invest in them. We say we are preparing the future for our children. We're investing for our children. Then we fail to invest.
Where will
in
you
them.
Get like the time?
So as we are doing this, where do you get time
both
for working?
Parents have to, you know, chase for careers. How do you strike a balance to raise children? Because I have to be at work. I have to ensure that the family is provided.
It all goes priority.
I provide for the family and I have to ensure that everything is okay financially at home. Where do you expect, Dixon, for us to have the time to even go to sit in a class of children and see how they are taught? Hey.
Like you know, a day has 24 hours. Not so. Your child is at school almost like, let me use
half.
Maybe half. Maybe
close to half.
Close to, maybe let's say 6 hours averagely. Now, those 6 hours, in a term, you fail to create like 1 day or even 2 days to come and have like 30 minutes of just seeing how the environment is. Sure, then you're seeing you're investing for your children. How much are you investing in them? Much as you're investing for them. Because it comes back to what we are doing for them. So you might be investing for children. You're always struggling, juggling here and there. Going early, coming back late.
I leave home at 6. Yes. Go back home at 5 or 7.
Yes.
Between 5 and 7.
Dixon,
where do you expect me? Because I already have stress from work. I'm chasing many things at work. how do you expect me to even start going to look at how the children are, you know, using their gadgets or what, even going to school and sit in a class? Honestly,
you see what?
Are you encouraging people maybe to have non-working parents or non-working partners?
Mbaraka, I want you to know that parenting is intentional. There's no option. Two, we always get leave. Even if you're a businessman, actually, for businessmen, when they have time, actually, they are better than us who are working in offices. But you always have leave. So how do you schedule your leave? And for what reason? Because like when I'm going for my leave, for my annual leave, I program it. I know that I'm going to go in this month because my purpose of going for this leave is to do A, B, C, D. I am going to rest, but as I rest, I also want to achieve this. And among the my intentions of leave should be giving enough time for my children. Because for me, I don't have a holiday. For them, they have holiday. They will come home and have their holiday. But for me, I only have to use leave. So how we prioritize our time matters. I also know that sometimes you are not 100% perfect, that you always reach at work on time. There's other days when you get there late for other different reasons. Not even jam, but for your personal.
You get tired. I mean, you get tired as a human being.
But you have intentional. This is, you know, with parenting, it is you. And with your children, it is you that must model them in what you want them to be tomorrow. You must shape them, and they must see what you're doing. So create time. Talk to your boss and say, you know what, tomorrow I am going to, like the way when our children are reporting at school, we always ask for permission.
Yes.
Said, I am going to come late tomorrow.
Because I'm taking back the children at school.
So even at in the month, you can tell your boss and say, you know what, I am requesting that tomorrow I come a bit late because I want to first do this at school for my children. And maybe this is how I'm going to compensate. For example, if you don't have leave at that moment, you can agree with the boss, this is how I'm going to compensate that time. And I don't think there's any boss who can refuse you to do that because most of them are also parents.
I think that should come from the work. From the work environment, bosses should be able to understand some of these things.
The way you negotiate, the way you present your
should
matter.
It be even a negotiation between you and the boss, or it should be like a deliberate policy from all employers are required to give you that
bosses
space.
Bosses who are very autocratic, those authoritative, authoritarian bosses, they don't want to know.
All they want is your.
For them, even if you have seen bosses where a woman gives birth by a C-section, and it is say after 1 week I want you at work. Very insensitive, very inconsiderate. Those bosses are there, but I am sure that even then it is you the print. Make sure that you create time and plan well and say, even when this is happening between this and this, I'm going to do this.
Let's go back to children.
Uh-huh.
You are talking about, because we've handled the working parents. Should there be, for example, apportioning of roles? For example, the father should be able to attend to kids, maybe say for this month, then the mother should take on the second month, because then if you're having both parents working, you're likely to have all of them actually absent. How do you deal with that?
That portioning may not come like the way I've said, that 1 month, 1 month, no. But let me give a daily. What happens like with me? I like to talk about my personal experience, looking at what I do. Now, for me, my wife works from home.
That's quite beautiful.
Yeah, she works from home. That's because her work is, she's worked with Compassion International as a communication specialist for African region.
But she's working from home.
Yes, because she's working from home.
Since COVID time, right?
Okay, as Compassion, they have that, that branded deal. Working environment.
Hybrid.
Yeah, hybrid. You can work from home. So for fewer, she works from home. But for me, I have to go to office.
Yes.
So every morning, I am the one who takes children to school.
That is your responsibility.
It's my responsibility.
No debate about it.
No. If I am unable, we agree. I am not going to make it so this morning. Maybe sometimes I can come with so many things I want, because I do many things here and there. And sometimes I want to use, for me, I concentrate well in the night if I want to do my personal business.
So she knows you must drop the
children. So we agree that this, now that I'm going to do this in the night, I might be able to wake up early. So
we are the one kindly help.
Help. So we agreed. Again, pushing the roles, you agree now, for me, I'm going to do this, for you, you do this. and then we see where we meet. If I'm not available,
you have to come in.
Yeah, you come in. Mm. So it's upon the family to agree. And it shouldn't be like now the issue of taking student school, it's not that it has to be me, no. But we just agreed. Who is able to do it?
Mm.
And because
for me, given your, because you have to
drop them
at the end of the day, you just continue to work.
I mean, I continue to work. Mm. And I take them, and then for her, she has to remain at school. So it was not making sense for her to drop
them. Yes, and then coming back home, yeah.
Then, homework, both of us, it's our responsibility.
Mm.
So for us, from 7 up to 9, there's no TV in our house. And they do it from the sitting room, I mean from the dining.
And the children are now aware
so
of that.
Yes, so there's no TV. For all of us as adults, even if there's something very interesting, 8 p.m., 7 p.m., to 9 p.m., there's
no
TV.
Authoritarian family.
So the authoritarian. It's actually, we are authoritative because we discussed with them.
Yes.
Actually, and first, our children, maybe they are very good because we understand each other and we always talk.
Mm.
And we agree on the discipline strategies. Because we have a family identity, we believe that we are the Tumranyes.
Yes.
We even have a government. So we agree with them.
Mm.
We say, now, Mr. President, sir, because we have a president, a vice president, a prime minister.
Mm.
So what do you think? Because we are raising these children holistically. We are trying to make sure we raise all their potential, different abilities. So they are.
But that requires a very stable family, a family intense communication.
Because I'm raising this child to be responsible tomorrow.
But sometimes partners are not actually in that good communication.
Now that's where the problem is. But for us, the good thing that we are
in good communication.
We want to be a role model to our children. And we know we are marriage counselors, we are parenting coach, we are all child advocates. We want to make sure to walk the talk.
Yes.
So what we do with our marriage, what we do with our children
is what you speak to others.
Mm. We don't want to speak things. I'm an inspirational speaker. Mm. I don't want to speak like, I just read things, then I come and say no.
And then
no.
Say yes.
Mm. I want to make sure that what I talk is what I walk, is what I live. So I want to give practical solutions based on what I have seen. That it works for me, mm-hmm. It can work for you. It may not work for you the same way. But I say, for me, I have done this, try it and see what happens. If it works for you, well, and if it doesn't work for you, there's this plan B.
There are those traditional roles of fathers and mothers.
But
how
now
do you balance this?
These, days, like, these days, things are changing, by the way. For example, we grew up knowing that the raising of children is for only mothers.
Mm.
But these days, because of the working environment, the corporate class, things are changing. Because, for example, before my wife was working from home, she was working here in Kororo, when she was still at the head office of Compassion.
Mm.
But now she's attached to Colorado Springs in USA. That's where her bosses are. She used to leave home at 5. Or sometimes 6 a.m.
Before
me. She gets home at 7, the earliest. 7 p.m. the earliest. But mostly, and she has left Kampala 5:30, 5. And then 2 hours, 3 hours, you know, from Kampala to Mukono. That jam is not a joking subject.
So the roles have also shifted.
Yes, so I was always in charge.
You have to make sure the children have already taken bath. They have.
Yes. Now, even like on Sundays, okay, for her, she's a deep sleeper. For me, I wake up very early.
Mm.
So every morning, I wake up early, I prepare them. Sometimes even leave when she's not even aware that we have left. And it's okay with us. It's not a weakness that as I say, no. Mm. Because all of us have our own challenges here. We struggle in this area, but here we are superb.
Dixon, we have to wind up this conversation, mm-hmm. but I want you to talk about influence. How do parents deal with influence? Of, for example, content that these children have been able to access on these gadgets. How do you deal with them and how do you put them in the right direction?
Now, parents, first of all, as you give this gadget to your child, make sure that you are able to monitor that content. And how do you monitor that content? Take time. For example, let me also begin with even TVs. Some parents don't give gadgets to their children, but they all have TVs, most of us, TVs. As your child is watching that cartoon, pay attention to know why are they interested in that kind of a cartoon. Because children have particular stations of cartoons which they like.
Mm.
And even on those particular programs, they have their own programs which they like at a given period of time.
Yes.
Be inquisitive. No, why do you like this program? Take time to watch with them and know what they are watching. The adults, maybe for us who have now, those who have youth, teens and youth, they have, by all means, they have these gadgets.
Mm.
They have these gadgets with them. But Monta, if they're on social media, are you part of social media? Are you part of any platform where they are? Because we have said we are now living in a virtual space, a virtual world.
Yes.
Where we have no option but to be there. So if your child is on maybe Facebook, are you friend with that child on Facebook? Sometimes you may just be there, even if you don't like Facebook
or just be Instagram, there to monitor.
Just be that monitor what your child is doing. Because, and sometimes if you're a harsh parent, your child might block you.
You can't block me and your father.
If you're a harsh parent and you don't, instead of coming and saying this was good, because now if you become authoritarian in parenting these days, you will not manage.
You lose
the whole thing. Because our children are more critical, they are very assertive, they have high self-esteem, they are more exposed than us because of in these tech things, they are tech savvy and they are better than us. So you as a parent, you need to always talk to them.
Have you interfaced with parents whose children have blocked them on Facebook?
Yes. They say that for me, I don't know what to do. Even some of them are not even there, so they don't know what happens there. But then they hear from others.
Yes.
There's another parent recently who sent me a message saying that my child, he was following he always follows the status of his daughter.
Mm.
So he told me that this is what I'm seeing from my daughter. How can I be helped? And we talked. And most of the things the daughter was talking about him.
Mm.
But how did he able to get that information? He was there to monitor what the daughter is always statusing.
Do you help some of these parents? How do they reach you?
Because they come. Like for me, my articles are always shared in the news vision, yes, sometimes on Data Monitor, sometimes it's always shared them weekly on social media, on WhatsApp, Messenger, and Facebook. And
my contacts are there. Easily access.
So they always contact me and get to me. Oh, now and of course I'm always out training and talks. They follow me a lot. So they always get back to me. I always get feedback. Others always get back to me, ask how can I go about this, and always tell them. We always chat and we share a lot. So monitor, and even on that phone, when you give it to your child, come and even go in the history.
Go and see the history, the recent
what was the child trying to do? If they deny you at a point, and maybe they date immediately.
Then
use
you
different
have,
ways.
Exactly,
yes. No, as a parent, you have to be very wise.
And you have to be on the top of the game.
On top of the game. Because, absolutely. Yes, much as they think that they are wiser than us,
but you, should
you
be
must be
on
top
to.
Of the game. All if right, you fail here, use here.
Thank you so much, Dickson, for that wonderful insights. And I hope that the children and the parents who are now home on Easter Monday watching this program, you've been able to pick one or two tips on how to deal with this whole issue of parenting in this 21st century. It's been Dickson
to Murami,
and actually is a parenting coach, and we've been discussing parenting in the 21st century. We are going to take a short break. When we return, Maiz Ramit is sitting down with a pastor, city pastor, who claims to have met God a few days while driving along Kampala Entebbe Express. We want to see that whether that man really met God and what is the picture of God looking like. We're taking a break. We're coming back in a short while.